you're on.
Well, my name is Jonathan Evison. Pretty much everybody calls me Johnny, and what do? I write narratives, and I wrote 8 of them before anybody published any of them. So I was 39 years old before I was ever published, and then I kind of became a minor, like, little literary sensation, and by that time, I had already swallowed the jagged pill that nobody was going to ever publish me, and it didn't matter. And so, you know, everything that's happening to me now in my life, and just being able to publish as well as I do, and actually have an audience of readers that aren't related to me by blood, is, like, fantastic, and it's just like gravy. You know what I mean? I never expected it. I was writing narratives. After a while, I was just writing books to become a more expansive person. I couldn't stop myself.
You had to have been interested in reading, too. As a kid, you didn't need to start writing.
Yeah, you know, here's the deal. My dad is kind of a deadbeat. Yeah. I mean, I don't have much of a relationship with him.
Yeah.
He's kind of a cool dude. I mean, he's still in my life. He's a cool dude. Like, I mean, he can speak a little Greek. He can speak some Latin. He's smarter than hell. He's an electronic engineer. Very brilliant, but we didn't really have a great filial thing or whatever you'd call that. But the one real solid thing he did for me was first he raised me on the oral tradition when I was a really little kid, younger than Owen, more like Emma's age. He would tell me stories, tiger stories. They were called tiger stories because I was into tigers. But I also suspect that he was very much into Kipling, because it was very much like the Jungle Book. But it was about these three little orphan tigers that grew up in the, you know, whatever, wherever tigers are, the Serengeti.
I don't know.
I'm an idiot now. But
Tigerland.
And eventually what would happen is I would tell the stories with him as I evolved, and I would tell the stories with him. I mean, he sounds like a great dad right now, and he was up until that point. And then, until he took me in the closet and made me kneel on right now. And then, you know, he read some Dickens to me when I was probably, you know, 6.
Wow.
And Owen and I have already started reading Dickens.
Like,
and then
he gave
me Breakfast of Champions by Kurt Vonnegut when I was 8 years old. Okay? That's the one, you know, it's got the pictures. So,
yeah.
You know, kept my internet. Hey, look, there's a picture of an asshole. My playground contemporaries are reading, like, Encyclopedia Brown and The Great Brain, and I'm reading about Wayne Hubler and Dwayne Hoover and, you know, Wide Open Beavers and stuff. And, like, instantly I recognize the Dickens DNA in it. But what that did for me is I did recognize, I mean, so much of it went right over my head. I'm 8 years old, but, like, I did recognize that sense of absurdity, and I did recognize humor as a defense mechanism or a coping mechanism and like a really important core thing to your worldview. So I did get the humor, and that's like why I always, you know, usually my writing has some sort of humorous slant, I guess, because that's where I approached it from.
But you also had to have gotten the lyricism, because you're writing, you're a lyrical writer. You have a rhythm to your writing that's really...
Count Basie, man. I just want my prose or satch or something. I want my prose to swing. That's all I care about. You know, like, the only rule I pay attention to, I keep in the back of my head, is that Chicago Manual of Style, like, you know, vary the lengths of your sentences kind of thing. But music does that naturally, you know, the phrasing of a saxophone or whatever. You know what I mean? Make your melody interesting.
So I got to ask, this is getting way ahead of where I normally is. But,
sorry, but, you're going to have this problem over and over.
It's okay. I'm there with you. Do you read your stuff out loud as you're working with it?
Well, yeah, interior out loud. I mean, I know the difference because I was in radio for years. So,
yeah.
I mean, I've listened to so many of my own, you know, sound, you know, air checks and stuff like that, that, like, I do know what I'm going to sound like out loud. I don't have to physically have that embarrassing thing where I'm standing and then the mailman comes.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, delivery, dude, what are you talking about?
So what was the first most powerful book that you can remember in your life? What was, I mean, one of those that really sort of,
I don't know if it was White Fang or Call of the Wild. Probably a Jack London book, though.
Jack London, yeah.
I mean, I just, you know, Jack London to me still is, like, one of the greatest storytellers who ever lived. I mean, the language is a little bit grandiose at times, and you know, the literary people will call it ham-fisted, but, man, the guy can write a story about some guy in a book of matches and make it the most compelling, interesting, with the highest stakes. I mean, I just think he's an amazing writer now.
What about your writing and storytelling? Do you remember as a kid... writing for the school paper, or
in third grade, I wrote because what happened is my family was in bad transition. My sister, who was my primary caregiver, died on her 16th, the weekend of her 16th birthday. She was basically, because my mom had four other kids, and, you know, they were teenagers down to nine. And so she just had her hands full. So my oldest sister and my second oldest sister pretty much cared for me, but mostly my older sister. And so she died in a freak accident. And then, my parents' marriage dissolved after 25 years. But as it was dissolving, my old man moved us up here and then moved himself back there. So here we are, fifth generation Californians, rare in itself for a white person. Dragged to the rainforest or whatever, where my mom was like basically, you know, walking around in curlers with one boob hanging out, trying to start a fire with a lampshade, you know what I mean? and so I was kind of acting out at that age too.
Yeah.
Transitionally, a lot of stuff was going on in our life, and that's when I found writing. And that's what gives my whole life purpose. I mean, I owe my whole life to writing. I do. I honestly believe that if I didn't write these stories, that I would, I'd probably be an IV drug user like many of my friends from the days when I was in bands, or yelling at parking meters.
So
I'm chemically manic off the charts.
What were some of those early stories you were working on?
In third grade, I wrote a book, a children's book that was actually published. Last thing I published in 30 years. We'll get to the drought. No, it was called The King Without a Crown, and it was about a king without a crown whose people loved him. He was such a benevolent king that they walked around and basically collected scraps of pretty stuff, you know, from nature, you know, but pop tops, I don't even remember what all, but they made him a crown. They glued it all together, and I think that's how it ended. And I drew the illustrations myself, but like my third grade teacher saved my life, you know. Mrs. Hanford, she saw, because I was having a behavioral problems, I was acting out, and I was also not only the youngest kid in my class, but I had skipped a grade. So I was almost 2 years younger than everybody. My mom didn't want them to put me in third grade or fourth grade, even though I'd had the third grade curriculum. So I had to stay in third grade. Otherwise, I'd be really a social, you know, who wants to be the only, you know, junior in high school with no pubic hair.
Yeah.
So she made, I think, the wise decision to hold me back. But the problem is I'd already learned about dinosaurs and penmanship or whatever. So it was just one more reason for me to act out. And to contain me, Mrs. Hanford, God love her, she's dead now, but she saw a spark in me. She saw something, and she saw that I wanted to write. And she would literally like isolate me in a corner just to, you know, make her own job easier as much as anything. But at the same time, she made a writer out of me, because I did. She quieted me down. I just sat there and I wrote. And I wrote The King Without a Crown, and Seattle Pacific University,
you
or somebody published
and Tom
it.
Robbins, who also got his start in third grade.
Yep. I remember deciding when I was going to be a writer, and it was in third grade. We were just, I don't remember anything about the moment except that my family was just like, expanding like a supernova.
Now, you haven't kept any of those things, have you?
Well, The King Without a Crown, you can probably find it at the library and, you know, Seattle Pacific University. I mean, they probably published like 50 copies of it.
Yeah.
They're in libraries somewhere. Allegedly, one of my parents has it somewhere.
Yeah.
Which I can't say for my first through third novels. Nobody has them. Not me, not anybody. I mean, I physically dug a hole and buried them and salted the earth.
So yeah, I heard.
I knew they were bad. I mean, it's just, you know.
You continued to write from third grade on.
Never stopped.
In what forms and fashions? I mean, for yourself, obviously, for classroom
assignments.
Well,
when I was about 12, I started a fanzine.
Ah.
Punk rock fanzine. Where I wrote record reviews.
Yeah.
I was pretty industrious, actually. I had it distributed, which meant I took it over on a ferry in a backpack and dropped it off at the comic shops at all the record stores, the punk record stores and stuff. In those days, there was, you know, Urban Renewal out in the U District and Time Travelers. And, you know, there's about five outlets where punk rock kids would go. And I would, you know, put a stack on them there. And then, about the same time I started getting into bands when I was about 13. And so then I was writing lyrics, sometimes really idiotic, but sometimes, I remember, I think I copped a line from T.S. Eliot for a punk rock lyric at some point.
And, nice.
So I just always knew that that's the path I wanted to take. And, I was 18, I think, or 19 when I wrote my first novel. You know, it was probably like 60, 70,000 words. And by the time it was over, it was about, 19-year-old kid writing his first novel. I mean, the fourth wall disappeared and it just became indulgent. But I could see far before the finish line that, you know, it wasn't going to be good. But I had to finish it. I knew that from being an athlete. I knew you're just not going
to
get good at something overnight.
To the line.
I know that when it was, 6 o'clock in the morning before school and it was pouring rain, you had to run your stairs anyway. You know what I mean? If you're going to get good. So
yeah.
I did that for 3 novels. I mean, I just knew at some point, obviously, I was excited. I mean, there were those points where you were writing them and you just think, oh, this is genius. And then, you know, by, you know, it didn't take long. By, you know, by 5 o'clock, you're like, eh, maybe not so much. So, like, I went through 3 novels that way. And then I think I wrote some good stuff for about 15 years and nobody published it because I didn't know how.
Yeah.
Some of it I think is good, really good. I mean, I've held on to it.
Yeah.
Anything I'm just embarrassed, I've just got rid of.
Charging along, there you are. I mean, you go through high school, you get into the punk rock groups and you're plowing in Seattle. When's your first professional assignment in writing? How did that happen? How did you go to
39 when I sold All About Lulu, my debut novel, which is like, you know, my 8th or something. And yeah. Guess what? It's a coming of age. Because guess what? I had written 3 failed coming of ages behind it. I guess I was finally ready to. I always kind of thought that the coming of age is kind of a great entree onto the literary big stage. You know what I mean? You write a kind of a voice novel that keeps the reader up at night and talks to him like a friend, and then you do something like West of Here, try to challenge yourself and write a world beater. You know what I mean? I always kind of believed in it. And then after 3, I don't know. You know, I just always felt like that was the. You know, I had plenty of time to think about it. I never expected to really be published. I mean, I did my due diligence. I sent out stuff, but I didn't do it smart, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, I was sending out 400-page novels to the bottom of an office building in New York with, like, just the most, like, pretentious, like, my query letters would be like, I'm sure you'll find my novel is of great social import. I mean, it's like, I mean, they probably didn't even, like, conk, and over the transom into the garbage.
Yeah.
See how quick I got that?
That's the mark of an athlete. You sent off that book, and it gets accepted by or picked up by an agent or what?
Well, no, I had like 3 or 4 agents before I ever sold a book.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the thing when I had Harriet Wasserman, who was like this legendary agent, and she was handling Saul Bellow, Reynolds Price, Oscar de Julios, and me. You know what I mean? So, like, where am I on the food chain? And also, she was about 140 at this time.
Wow.
I mean, she was, like, really old. I didn't, you know, I went and met her at the Century Club in New York, and it was like, I mean, they had to help her in, and it's like, she wasn't putting in a lot of office hours. In fact, her assistant, like, a year after I sold my book, I think it was already published, her assistant was like, what do you think of sending it to Jeff Klosky at Riverhead? And I'm like, I left the agency 2 years ago.
Jeez.
I sold the book, and by the way, Jeff Klosky said no.
Yeah.
So I didn't have an agent at the time. I'd been tracking Richard Nash because I thought Soft Skull was doing amazing things. Soft Skull was reminding me a lot of what Sub Pop was in the late 80s, you know, in Seattle music. I mean, it was like it had street cred and they had a great editorial voice and they were publishing irreverent stuff and they were doing amazing things out of a, you know, an apartment in Brooklyn, basically. So Richard Nash was on my radar. He's like, that's an editor I'd like to work with, you know. And so Richard kind of, you know, I sent him my book and I didn't hear from him for a while.
And you were living here in the Northwest.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I didn't hear from him for a while, but I guess he was in love with the book during that time. And I reinvented it even more, you know, in the interim. So it was even better by the time it came down to that. And at the time I didn't have an agent. I was just going straight to the editors. I was tracking the editors that I liked.
Uh-huh.
And so, Richard was interested in publishing my book, so then I got on the phone and called any agent I wanted to. You know, I talked to Al Zuckerman. He's like, I'll tell you what I'm going to do, kid. I'm going to take your book to Miami next week, and I'm going to read it, but I'm going to warn you in advance. Lulu might have to be a guy, and I might have to give him a gun. You know what I mean? I was like, okay, thanks. I mean, that guy sells everything, too. I mean, he's like a huge agent. And I just went down the line, and I finally chose Molly Glick because she was the hardest on my book. Because I just always trying to write the best book. And she was like, she loved the book, but she was like, I think we could take it to a whole other level. And so, you know, I picked her and, you know, I'll be with her forever.
Wow.
I mean, she gives me such great editorial. I want editorial.
Yeah.
I mean, this is a collaboration, you know. It's not about me, you know, talking at the reader. I mean, without the reader, you know, it's like what, you know, I think Fred Astaire said about Ginger Rogers. And maybe Ginger Rogers said it about herself. I don't remember. But, like, she had to do everything he did backwards and heels. And that's how I feel about the reader. That's the greatest tool in my belt. So, like, I know it's not always, I feel like in the modern era, it's sometimes kind of frowned upon. It's not very literary to think about. When you talk about thinking about the reader, a lot of people think you're talking about the marketplace or you're just talking about that person collaborating, the end user, the person, you know. That's what I mean. Mystery writers know that. Do you know what I mean?
Like, really,
you know,
easy for writers and us to get confused to think that communication is a one-way story. And
the
it's
more
not.
One-way it is, the worse it is.
That's right. Know? You get your first published book. How'd you get the news that it had been picked up, that it had been published, that it was going out? Did somebody call you?
I don't know. I mean, I think it was just kind of a email trail over a couple weeks. It looked like it was going that way. I mean, I didn't have a rep. It was just me talking to Richard and him answering.
Did you get to see it in a bookstore? Did you?
The first time I got it, I mean, the first time I saw a galley, I mean, Richard had his priorities, right? Who cares if the author has it? I mean, he's just going to make sure the bookseller has it. So the first time I saw it, I went into my local, which is Eagle Harbor Books on Bainbridge Island. It's been there since the 70s.
Great bookstore.
And I went in, and Jan Healy was the buyer at the time, a dear old friend, and she ran out and she goes, "Oh, I've got something to show you." Like, she had it before me, and it was kind of neat. So I saw it like that. But that's better, though. You know, I got it from the bookstore. And now, you know, I love Eagle Harbor. I mean, I think I'm the top two selling books of all time in that bookstore, Lulu and West of here. I mean, the island has just been such a supportive community. Everybody I ever went to high school with, when young writers say, like, you know, "I'm getting a publishing deal, how do I find readers?" I go, "Try your high school alumni." Yeah, those guys that shoved your head into the locker, they actually want to know you now. They will, then they'll buy 10 of your books. You know what I mean? I use their names all the time. I use the names from people I went to high school with, not in context, not their characters, just because I know they get a kick out of it. You know what
I mean?
So like,
the names appear in, as characters?
Oh, yeah. It's like a little game I play. Nice. Because if that person goes up, buys like $20.
Yeah.
And I don't teach, you know? A guy's got to make a living.
That's neat.
I mean, most of my favorite books don't work on some level. You know, I'm not really interested in short, perfect novels. I mean, Moby Dick is a mess. Do you know what I mean? But it's also modernism 50 years before modernism. I mean, he throws every mode in the book. He's got, you know, narrative nonfiction, poetry, essay, everything's in there. And the center holds, because it's like, I like those works where the work can just barely sustain the force of its own invention. You feel the writer, the artist working their hardest, and yet they're still giving it to you as a reader. You're just pushing that boundary between maybe being too ambitious with the reader, maybe giving the reader too much credit, because you can fail that way. But that's the way I want to fail.
Yeah.
Compared to the antithesis, which is not giving the reader enough credit, not working with the reader enough, and then you're just, you know.
Okay, you focused on structure and timing and plotting and all the rest, but you haven't mentioned characters. How alive are your characters in here?
Your
characters talk to you.
Yeah, well, I mean, they still live with me. You know, I mean, long after the book's put away, they're still a part of me. I mean, once you get inside the character's shoes, really, really inhabit the character, you know, and experience their emotions, and they're different from your emotions, but they're somehow close enough or connected to you as a your human experience that, like, you know, it can feel real for you. I don't know. The characters are, they're as alive to me. I mean, they're carbon-based life forms.
Yeah.
I mean, if you get down to it.
Yeah.
They're as real to me as you and Sally. I mean, they really are. I mean, they have a will. They have dreams and yearnings. They have conflicts.
Has a character ever changed the story on you?
Oh, many times. Yes. Many times. So, but, you know, and sometimes I got to wrestle with them. Like, you know, Nabokov talked about his characters as his galley slaves. And if I wrote that way, and he did a great job of that, you know, I'm not going to. That's just not my MO. Like, you know, I mean, I write to become more expansive. So if I have it all figured out, I don't even like to outline. I grope around in the dark, and eventually I have outlines. By my eighth or ninth draft, when I actually know what I'm doing, then I figure out a more cogent way to organize my information and plot the arc and so forth. But the outlining comes later. The first thing I want to do is to have some burning question inside of me, you know, that needs exploration, you know, that hopefully can connect with a reader or readers to, you know.
Nice.
But I want to be more expansive by the time it's over. So, you know, the whole thing about write from your experience, maybe, but, you know, I mean, there's a lot of truth to that, too, but sometimes I think it's important to push your, you know, I'm not a 56-year-old black, parole officer. I'm not a 6-year-old Clallam Indian boy living in the 19th century. I'm not a new woman of the 1890s. I'm not any of my characters, but, like, you know, between what you learn about them. And that's the thing about the research, is that I didn't want people to smell the coffee on my breath in that 19th century material. So, like, you know, I'd worked, deductively, general. I read the big narratives that I was trying to frustrate about how it was settled by these great men and how they beat down the Indians and how some Indians fought back. And the, you know, the big wide-angle historical texts, I read those first. And then I just sort of whittled it down, started doing personal interviews, started getting these little tape-bound personal narratives written by pioneer women and Indian women and stuff that you could only find in the research section. That, you know, it's like, you know, I mean, and they're not always super spectacular reading. I mean, I've read stuff where it's like 20 pages of somebody had a barn party, and it's just like the lady will go on about what everybody wore, a lot of exposition. But after you read all of that stuff and sort of digest it, you really get more of a sense of what it was like to be alive in the times. Mm-hmm. That's what I want. I don't want an information dump. I just want to know what it felt like to be alive during a time. Or
so. Do you take notes in a journal and pieces, scraps of paper?
Dude, sometimes I get so hammered out here, and I feel like by the campfire, I fill these spiral notebooks, and I have no business writing. I'm not, you know, and neither did Faulkner, as far as I'm concerned. So I read the first sentence of Absalom, and I go, that guy is drunk. Okay, I realize it's this beautiful long sentence, but you don't change points of view five times in a sentence. I guess you do if you're Faulkner, but like, it's just,
Yeah.
I have no business writing, but the notes, I have these major breakthroughs. Since I'm manic and I self-medicate, I have these major breakthroughs, these major points of lucidity where I can suddenly see something like West of Here with all these points of view, and I can sort them out. It's easier because, like, you know, the world is slowly spinning. And I look at my notes in the next morning, and sometimes I'm like, holy cow, man. How did I even get there? And I mean, I nail it. They're lucid.
Yeah.
Problems I've been trying to beat for months, you know, like, you know, drawn. I mean, with that book, I was drawn on my ceilings, drawn on my walls with, you know, dry erase pens. I was like peeing in jars because I was afraid to take my eye off this thing, which had a nucleus and like 80 lines drawn out of it. I called them like thought maps or something. It just sounds like a nightmare. It's like Russell Crowe in that movie about math.
Yeah. Right.
But like, I don't know where I was going with that. I'm just crazy. I guess, you asked me, you know, do I write in a notebook maybe?
Yeah. How do you actually do your writing? Do you have a regimen? Do you have a discipline? Do you get up at a certain hour? Do you only work in a particular place? Do you have a superstition? How does...
All of the above. I mean, it used to be like in a perfect world. Look, I've got two young kids now, so like everything's changed.
Yeah.
I mean, in a perfect world, what I would do, even when I was writing unpublished novels, I mean, I had to be schlepping horse shit or something, you know, selling telemarketing sunglasses. I was always doing a full-time job to support the writing, but even then, I would get up in my ultimate writing period, and I'm naturally a nocturne, but I would get up at 4:30 because that way I knew I was giving my best to my writing. You don't screw around at 4:30 in the morning.
Right.
You know what I mean? It's like you should be in bed. It's like you don't get distracted. Even now with the internet, you don't get distracted. You stay on task. You're giving your best, most vital energy. And instead of exhausting you, I'd write till like 10 o'clock when I had to go landscape or whatever.
Yeah.
I was energized. You know what I mean? I actually had more energy because I got it. Because if you don't do it that way, like for me, it's like I just beat myself up all the time for being lazy and not working. Writers are great procrastinators. Ooh. I know that. That's like the one universal thing I know about all the writers I know. It's like we all try our hardest not to write in a way. I mean, you sit down and it depends what you're writing. You got two characters in a room with a little tension. I mean, sparks fly, you know what I mean? But a lot of times you just got to write exposition or get your guy out of a cab into a bar. I mean, that stuff is like, it can be drudgery.
So at 4:30 in the morning in the ideal world, is there...
Well, now my kids, it doesn't work because they used to get up at 4:30. Guess what?
Yeah,
they ain't in the slightest little tapping. They're up at 4:45. I'm gone. And that, you know, so now what I do is I come out here to the cabin a couple days a week. My wife keeps the kids on the island and I write for 12, 16, I mean, really 24 hours a day. I mean, because I'm always, even when I finally sit down on the computer or the tablet or whatever, I'm sitting out by the fireplace, like I said, you know, taking notes or just like, but it's 24/7 concentrating on the work. And that's a different my equilibrium just has to change. I've had this conversation with Stuart Onan too, and he's like that too. It's like you just have to learn to carry a little. I mean, I text myself 20 times a day with little things. I mean, just you're always writing. You just have to find an equilibrium that you can manage, and that's hard with young kids, you know. For me, writing is pretty yogic in the sense, not that I do any yoga, but like it is almost an altered state. I mean, it is like. It is a discipline. It sometimes it takes an hour and a half to get there. Do you know what I mean? To quiet my head enough to get inside the store, to delve beneath the words on paper. Because as long as it's just words on a screen or on paper, I'm not doing my job. You can't bring the story to life that way. You know. So coming back to language, it's never about like. Overthinking my sentences or working my sentences really hard. Again, I just want them to swing. In fact, sometimes my sentences, if they become too sprawling and they came out that way, I'll chop them up or I'll dirty them up because they need to be dirty. Because you know what? This guy's turning on a lamp. He's not, you know, isn't, you know what I mean? It's just when the language calls for it. So you called me lyrical. I don't think of myself as that. I feel as myself, you know, I feel like, kind of a working man's writer in terms of like I've got information, characters, and motivations, and I'm gonna try to give it the language treatment that the situation deserves.
Yeah,
you know what I mean. And if it's life and death, and you're in the middle of a thing, and that may come out lyrical, but generally speaking, I just think of the words and the language as sort of the blood running through the veins of the story. And so I don't ever, like, if I go back, I read big swaths of text. Like some people go back, I guess, and just read each sentence. I go back and read. 2 pages because it's sort of more of a mood, or almost like in musical terms, more of a movement or whatever. I just want to make sure that whole thing is flowing. I want it to be like water. I'm mixing my metaphors like crazy now, but you know what I'm saying? I just want flow. I want to get it to the reader in the most fluid and apropos way as possible.
Yeah.
And that isn't always big sprawling language. Sometimes it's really blunt. The thing I'm writing now is like, I mean, I'm not able to use 80% of my vocabulary because that's just sort of the dialect of the narrator. So I have to be, so much of the creativity is figuring out how to work around the obstacles the self-obfuscation. I mean, you know, that's something Faulkner knows a lot about. See, that's the thing, I'm obsessed with Faulkner, you know what I mean? I'm obsessed with him, but I don't really, you know what I mean? It's like, I read The Barn Burning all day long, but you know, once it starts announcing the author too much, it gets too authorial. Like, it's like, okay, then it becomes too much to me. But at the same time, I want to push that envelope. You know what I mean? I want to push myself as the author, but I never want it to be a monologue I never want to have my reader at arm's length, you know?
Now, can you read recreationally while you're writing? I mean,
I could totally see why you'd ask that question. There was a time when I couldn't.
Yeah.
You know, because when I was younger in my development, like the last thing you'd want to do is like read somebody like Tom Robbins or Kurt Vonnegut or Charles Portis or somebody who's got this really distinct like voice, because you'd be afraid you'd catch it and then pretty soon you're emulating them. At this point, after like 14 books, I mean, I just know what my strengths are. I know what I can do. I know what I can't do. And that's what I'm trying to do most of the time is stuff I don't even know I can pull off. Then no. I mean, it's just more of a matter of time. Do I have 3 hours to read today? I should probably use the 3 hours to write, but I can do it.
Yeah.
I wouldn't want to read, so like when I was reading West of Here, a million people were like, you've got to read Annie Dillard's The Living, you know, or you've got to read, there was a T.C. Boyle book. I don't know if it was Riven Rock. I don't know what it was, what book. Somebody kept telling me, you got to read that book because it sounds like what you're up to. And so like those books I avoided like the plague. I still haven't read. Just because I don't want to feel like after the fact I'm being derivative even. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
The whole point is to like just have it all come from me somehow and my experience or what I don't want to use craft, or I don't want to use intertextuality or stuff I know about literature in an obtuse way, I guess. Yeah. I mean, but at the same time, I said to you, I think of it as this dialectic where I'm kind of like doing things some of my favorite books didn't, or I wish they had, or you know, or just as an author, like I try to reinvent myself every time, like, and I think, you know, God, I wish Charles Bukowski would have tried to write a Western, you know, just for the hell of it, instead of writing the same story for 40 years. I always wanted to be that guy that kind of pushes myself. I mean, I've got one theme, you know, reinvention, that's it. Hemingway had one thing. I don't think I need a lot of themes, but I just always want I want to approach the problem of storing, and it is a problem, telling a story. Let's just call it a problem. Boy. I mean, with the story, there's this information. This is just what happened. I mean, like, you talk about the story objective as you can be, and this is what happens.
Yeah.
And this is how you got to squeeze it between the signposts of the beginning and the end. But you start switching points of view and having different limited points of view, then you can really start to play with the information of the story and really start to sort of elicit your reader's attention and get your reader to really kind of be more a part of the process. And again, comes back to the thing of thinking your reader is your best tool. And when I say reader, I don't mean, you know, the 25 to 54-year-old male. I mean me, the book I want to read. I write the books I want to read, you know what I mean? That's all I do, is write books that I want to read.
Now, are you doing any workshops for writers? And
I'm the worst teacher ever. Uh-huh. I'm a great pep talker. I can inspire them. They'll run out of the room wanting to write. They'll go, God, if this guy can do it, I can do it. He's a train wreck. But I don't want to teach. I just don't believe in it, in a way. Yeah. I mean, I feel like I could teach a young writer some shortcuts, but in doing so, I don't think I'm doing him any favors. I mean, the more the writing is instructed, the further somebody gets away from being a truly unique voice. I mean, Walt Whitman wasn't instructed. Charles Dickens wasn't instructed. I mean, the writers of the writers that'll survive the epics to me weren't. I don't know. And yet, I know a lot of great writers that came out of Iowa and stuff like that. You know, it's just not something. It's just not for me. I don't like prep work either.
We're at the end of our tape almost. You got to have something.
I think you got a good 3 minutes there.
I think I can get it down to a minute.
You might need another tape.
Dude. I'm going to have to fill it in with background pictures. Seriously, this is wonderful. But anything you want to throw in and add or talk about that's got about a minute and a half.
I guess just don't forget why you're doing it. I mean, I feel like a lot of the people that I talk to, just period, I mean, as in anybody who's listening, is just aspiring writers. I mean, who knows, you know, like probably a good proportion of my readers is other people that want to write, that read because they want to be writers. And I just is to not forget why you're doing this. You know what I mean? I had the advantage of failing for so long that I never got hung up on you know.
Nice.
I just think that it's kind of a thankless job, as sometimes being a parent is also, you know, I mean, it's like, you could be a New York Times bestseller and you're still not, you know, you're not reaching that many people. Just appreciate whoever you can reach. And remember, if you're not reaching anybody, you're expanding yourself. Just don't forget why you're doing it, you know. And that's because it's, I mean, for me, it's my lifeblood. It's just like, it's, listen to me talk. I'm a mess. And you're going to edit this and I'll look somewhat cogent. But the fact is, when I sit down to write, man, I got control. Yeah. I can like, well, that, you know, rant goes, or this, you know what I mean? I can build worlds that way in a way that I can't in real time.
That's
what I get out of it.
You love what you're passionate about your writing. That's
I love awesome. It. I mean, I have to do, it's like breathing for me. Yeah. It really is. I mean, ask my family. I'm miserable. I mean, I mean, I'm hard to live with if I don't do it eventually, because I can't be fully present anywhere else. It's just gnawing at me. It needs to be done. It needs to get out. It's a compulsion. It has to be done. And if it's done, and most of the time it has to come out of my sleep, I may get 3 hours less sleep. I may sleep 4 hours, but I'm in a better place for my family the next day having done it. That's how much I need it.
Johnny, we want to thank you so much. This is so cool. Not just to have us out here, but to share with us like what you've been doing.
Oh, it's my pleasure. I knew it'd be awesome. Fun. I knew it'd be fun.
Yeah. And
we're going to cook some steak. You're not going to just run out on me now, right?
Oh, no.
Oh, we got all this food. And
oh, yeah.
I'll drink your Jameson.
Anything for you?